if you noticed, Allison called out four or five different internal partners that were critical in helping pick out the right KPIs for those clocks. With all of her clocks picked out, though, the logical next step is to prioritize which clocks get the most attention first. And with all of those different partners, all of those different anecdotes she was hearing, all of that new data, how does a new CRO like Allison start to pick out those priorities?
Yeah, this is where the fun begins. So I would say in the beginning of this, like when I went through this exercise at LiveRamp, deciding the macro and micro categories took months and months and months. So the good news is Brian and I were able to really agree that we didn't need to like rewrite the world there. We could just leverage that. So we saved ourselves like a good quarter and a half of time, because the next phase is the, like, if you can imagine a spreadsheet, I have the rows being the metrics and the columns being the data, but the first column is goal, right? So what is the goal? And again, this is where the fun begins. Now with LiveRamp, when we went through this exercise, we had attempted to do this like a year and a half ago or something. I just don't think we were ready, but we had actually engaged with some consultants to help us figure out that goal. And it was a really challenging process because they'd come in and they would suggest things and we'd be like, well, where are you getting that? Why do you have that point of view? And it was, you know, based on ex consultants, you know, client base. And then when we'd push them to give us examples of the customers that were in their client base, they were not companies that we had any interest in comparing ourselves to, you know? So then you honestly, I mean, I hate to say this, but this is what happens. You, like Brian and I, even when we were talking about this, we started pulling up proxies, public companies that we do either aspire to be like or feel we're similar enough to that we can start looking at. You start doing research, you start asking your board to start poking around because you need to get some benchmarks and some baseline. You know, some you can say there's industry standards like pipeline, you know, there's the classic, you want 3x of your pipe against goal. Others are harder to determine. And then there's some, like I think sales excellence, like average sales cycle and close rate and ASP, it's really just about the trend line, right? So I remember one thing when we did this at LiveRamp was for some of these, the kind of the goal was just up and to the right. And so then the outcome was always, we always had like a graphic to support the data to kind of show which way the trend line was heading. But yeah, like I said, some industry standard, you know, we all kind of know what renewal rates are healthy and what net retention rates are healthy. We all kind of know the pipeline stuff, but things, you know, I'm even thinking about things like net new logo heads, like or net new logo ads, like that's really specific to us. Ramp time. You want that just going in the right direction. But then there's like sales and marketing as a percent of revenue. I'm really relying on finance to tell me what they want to see here based on peer data.
The thing you're making me think about as you're kind of listing off all of these different examples is I would be very nervous in the midst of this process that I have either picked the wrong thing to measure or that I might be too heavy on lagging indicators, right? So I might be too heavy on measuring results. And by the time I figure out that there's a problem, it might be too late to make an impact on this quarter, the next quarter. Do you think about that in terms of the distribution or I guess the split between leading and lagging indicators in your world clocks? And is there a moment where you might say, oh, I think we picked the wrong thing?
I don't worry because this is not the only thing we're going to look at. And I think this is where the partnership with sales ops becomes incredibly, incredibly important. This is like my scorecard or this is my dashboard that I want to look at quarter over quarter to assess the health of the business and make sure that we're spending our time on kind of broad-based initiatives in the right direction. But within the quarter, I'm always looking to sales ops to tell me what's really going on. So imagine this is like, I'm gonna take a swing at an analogy. We'll see if this works. But like, imagine that we're in a hospital and this is kind of the patient's chart. Like this is kind of a snapshot in time of how the patient is doing. But we need the doctors and nurses to be constantly measuring that patient and coming and saying, hey man, there's like a spike in something or something's trending down. So a great example of this would be, you know, again, at LiveRamp, we have this snapshot in time, we're looking at it on a quarterly basis, but sales ops would come to me all the time and say, hey, I'm a little bit worried about the distribution of upsell versus net new logo and how that's trending this quarter. And we might say, okay, like we need to go and crank the wheel on account planning to try to increase our pipe and upsell, for example. Like there's data that's happening in real time that we need sales ops to really be the finger on the pulse to help us know what's going on. Because you're right, like this is not going to help you understand the business if you only look at this. And then I'll also say to your first point about being worried about these being the right things, like, hey man, like, you can change it if it's not meaningful. If you're not ending up taking any action because of this data, or you're not making, it's like, this data should either make you feel good or make you take action. And if there's a data point that's like not eliciting either response, it's probably not doing anything for you, you know? Get rid of it, replace it.